Everyone, my name is Romeo Belciuk. Welcome to this webinar about we are going to talk about analytical driven modeling API. Thank you for being here today. You are valuable members of our community, and your feedback is very important for us. Because today you are going to see some features which are not released yet and are under development, please take a minute to read this statement. Thank you. Okay. So agenda for today. In the beginning, Cătălin, my colleague, will talk a little bit about the big picture and what are the changes in this new implementation of analytical modeling in Revit. And after that, we are going to see which are the new API related to this big implementation. After that, we will going to see some samples. After that, we're going to talk about the deprecation of the existing API. And in the end, we are going to have a Q&A session. You can post your questions in the Q&A session. Cătălin?
Okay. So hi everyone, I'm Cătălin Lang. I'm the product owner for the team that handles the analytical model enhancement. Yeah, so we are improving the analytical modeling in Revit as we want to, first of all, to enable some analytical modeling automation. We want to offer engineers some model quality control tools in a BIM compliance, to offer also some control and flexibility over the analytical representation. In the same time, to allow engineers to use the physical model, the real model, as context in the analytical modeling. That's why we call it analytical driven modeling in physical context. Also collaborations within the structure analysis ecosystem. So we are not targeting a specific structure analysis solution. We are offering a bridge to any kind of structure analysis solution. And of course, because we are using Revit as platform, documenting the analytical model on this with the Revit capabilities. What's changed comparing with the current solution of the analytical model in Revit? So first of all, the current solution, we call it the derived analytical model, mostly because the analytical representation is derived from the physical one. It depends always on the physical, cannot exist without the physical representation. Only a few elements have the capability to derive the analytical model: beam columns, floors, walls, panels, slab side, and few others, but not always. There is only one-to-one relationship. So for each physical, only one analytical model can analytical element can be created, and only one specific analytical element. So for the linear element, we have analytical stick, and for surface physical element, we have analytical panel. You cannot represent a physical beam as a analytical panel. It's an extreme case, but yeah, some side cases from here. Also, the analytical elements projection on grid level can be manually defined, this kind of projection, and it sometimes is not feasible for each element in the model to have these settings to rely on the grids and level on the datums of the project. Also, we in the current solution, we have an auto detect adjustment system based on the physical model changes, which sometimes results in some strange situations, like you move a physical from one side, someone from another side of the building, position is changing. And of course, all these adjustments, most of these adjustments can be done only in the Antarctica model editor environment. And in this regard, we are currently are improving this representation. We are migrating from a direct Antarctica model, as we call it, to a contextual Antarctica model, the one built in the physical context, mostly to offer full control over the Antarctica elements. So the new Antarctica representation, it's totally independent from the physical. Only on user demands, the physical changes will influence the Antarctica model changes. So it's not some automatic tool or automatic process. We'll be able to build an Antarctica representation for any kind of objects, not just beam, brace, columns, floors, and whatsoever there, or any kind of object or group of objects will be able to have a representation in an Antarctica environment. Then we have the many ways we call it, the physical Antarctica relationship, which mostly means is not, you see in the previous direct Antarctica model, we have only one-to-one relationship. Now, not only an element, but also a group of elements will be able to have a representation Antarctica environment. Good example here could be the truss that in some cases is represented as a system of Antarctica members, but also might be useful to have it only one beam in the precast truss example, I think, or a stair as a slanted panel. So this also will be enabled. The next thing will be the automatic control through the grids and levels. So you will not need to define projection on grids on levels. It came automatically through the node, and you can control the elements, Antarctica elements position through this datum elements through grids and levels. Then, as I mentioned in the beginning, there will not, because the physical Antarctica elements are independent. You will be able to create a rule that will conduct the changes propagation system. So in other words, you'll be able to use APR or Dynamo or, I don't know, other kind of tools to define specific rules for you, for the workflow you are targeting. And yeah, in the end, because in the derived Antarctica model case, we have the possibility to adjust some Antarctica elements only in an editor. Now you can do it in Canvas directly without any need of opening a dedicated editor, in the same time interacting with the physical representation of for which users creates that Antarctica model. Okay, and yeah, a small representation here. So I think we should start from another video. Should have a play. Okay, perfect. Yeah. So yeah, it's like we would model the analytical model in a different in a structure analysis solution. One by one, this is a recording from the early stages of the project where the Antarctica member could be created only through 2 points. Now, yeah, we will see we are much more advanced, but in the same time, using full Revit capabilities to define this representation, copy, move, linked files, design options. I don't know what's there worth sharing. I think this is for the intro part. In the end, we'll have a question and answer questions. So I will let Romeo present you the changes in terms of API. And then in the end, we'll take some questions and of course, we'll try to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Cătălin. So after this short presentation from my colleague, now we can have a closer look at the API of the new analytical model implementation, which we are calling contextual analytical model. For this, we implemented completely new Revit elements, and of course, they are coming with a new API. First of all, we are going to talk a little bit about the analytical element. This is the base class for all analytical elements. It will replace a former analytical model. And here we can find some generic methods, let's say. For example, getTransform, which will return a transformation which reflects the analytical element orientation. We have here a property a material ID. So we can assign a material ID for an analytical element. Also, other methods like getReference or analyzes. As I said, some generic methods in the base class analytical element. The next thing is analytical member. This is an element which represents a linear element in the structural analytical model. It will replace analytical model stick and analytical model column. Instead of having different classes like we had before, we choose to implement a generic one. We implemented also some structural roles, as you can see. Here we have some values, beam, column, member, and girder. We can assign a structural role for an analytical member. These values are fixed and cannot be edited by users, but we plan in the future to give this possibility, and users will be able to edit this list, add new ones or delete some roles and so on. Moving forward, the creation of an analytical member is pretty easy. So the create method receives a document, of course, and a curve. The curve must be a line, an arc, or an ellipse. We don't support, for example, splines. You can see here a small sample. Pretty easy. Yeah. So create a line and then create an analytical member. And after that, we can assign a structural role. regarding the geometry, we have exposed some methods like getCurve, which will return the curve for an analytical member. SetCurve, which sets the new curve for an analytical member. What's worth mentioning here is for example, as you can see in the top right picture, if we have two members which are connected in one analytical node, and you use this method setCurve for one of them to set a new geometry for an analytical member, the elements will be disconnected if the end nodes are not in the same position. So as you can see in the top picture, after using set curve, the analytical members will be disconnected. If users wants to move the corner, but still wants to keep the connection, there are other ways for achieving that. Like I don't know. For example, you can use element transform utils, which is already exposed in Revit. As you can see in the bottom pictures, if you use this framework and move the common node, then the analytical members will still be connected. Other methods that we have here is a valid curve, which verifies if the curve is valid for an analytical member. Flip curve, this will flip the ends for a member. Some properties that we have here, structural section shape, this is a read-only property and will return the structural section shape for this member. Also, we have section type, which is represents the ID of the type from the structural family, which is assigned to this member. So members can have their own structural family. And of course, the rotation. We also have some methods related to releases and member forces. As you can see here, we have methods for return or set the member forces, release conditions, and release type. These methods were previously in the, they are very similar with what we have before for the existing API of the analytical model. Just some, I don't know, small enhancement. Moving forward. Now we are going to talk a little bit about the analytical panel. This is the new analytical surface element. It will replace the analytical model surface. We defined, like we did for analytical members, some structural roles, like floor, wall, and panel. This list is fixed, but in the future, we plan to offer users possibility to edit this list. The creation of the analytical panel, the create method, which receives a curve loop. The curve loop must be planar, not self-intersecting, and should not contain zero length curves. We have here a small sample how to create an analytical panel. Yeah, so create a curve loop and then call the creation method for an analytical panel. For the geometry manipulation, we expose some methods like getOuterContour, which will return the curve loop that defines the geometry of the surface element. We have some methods to validate if the curve loop is valid for a panel. It will check for planarity, for self-intersections. Now, in order to modify the analytical panel geometry, applications should use SketchEditScope framework. This is a framework which was exposed in the API in the previous releases. But we enhance it with a new method. We call it start with new sketch, which receive an element ID. And this will start a sketch edit mode for an element which at this moment may not have a sketch. So our panels, our analytical panels doesn't have all the time a valid sketch. Now, sketch edit scope will allow the application to create and maintain an editing session for a sketch. Also, another way of editing geometry is set outer contour. We expose this method mostly for Dynamo users who wants to edit analytical panels from Dynamo nodes. And we did this because sketch edit scope requires that no transaction should be active when you start a sketch edit session, which sometimes may not fully work with Dynamo, because Dynamo usually has a global transaction. And in order to for users to work with sketch edit scope in Dynamo, they should close the global transaction and start a sketch edit scope. And this, I don't know, may not be okay for all users. So this is why we expose this set outer contour, mostly for the users who wants to edit the panels from Dynamo nodes. Both methods for editing the geometry, sketch edit scope and set outer contour, will perform disconnection from, like you can see in this picture here, if we have a panel and the members, which are connected in one node, and then we modify the panel geometry by using sketch edit scope or set outer contour, the elements will disconnect if the end nodes are not in the same position. If the application wants to keep the connection, there are other ways, like I said before, element transform utils, for example. Relations, yes, so we have a method for returning the analytical opening IDs, which are cutting this panel, or we have a property sketch ID, which return the sketch associated with this Revit element, with the mention here that the sketch ID may be invalid. Analytical opening. This is an element which represents an opening in an analytical panel, for an analytical panel. So actually it will cut the analytical panel. It's a separate element. In the current solution, we don't have an opening element. It can be placed only on one panel at a time. So it can cut only one panel. That's why the creation method receives a curve loop and a panel ID, which represents the element ID of the analytical panel, which this opening must cut. The geometry get outer contour is very similar to the analytical panel. So we have get outer contour, which returns the curve loop for the opening. We have a method for check if the curve loop is valid for an analytical opening. This method will check for planarity, self-intersection. We shouldn't have zero length curves, but also it will check if the curve loop is in the same plane with the panel, but that must be cut. And also the curve loop must intersect the panel's geometry, because we don't allow the creation of an opening which didn't cut anything. In order to modify the geometry, you can use sketch edit scope or set outer contour. It's very similar with the analytical panels. Some properties, so we have the panel ID, which will return the ID of the host of the analytical panel, and the sketch ID, the sketch associated with this opening element. Yeah, what maybe was mentioned here, so we cannot, this open analytical opening will cut only one panel. It doesn't cut two panels. For example, if we put an opening on top of two panels, only one panel will be its host. Moving forward, the association between physical and analytical elements. We introduce a new concept. So the association in the current solution, the association between physical and analytical elements is fixed and cannot be edited by users. So when a structural column, for example, is created, an analytical column is created in the same time, and they are associated, let's say. This analytical column represents the analytical representation of that physical column. With this new implementation, we are creating an association manager, which will manage the association between analytical and physical elements. For the moment, supports one-to-one association, but in the future, we are planning to extend it to many-to-many associations, so to associate multiple analytical elements with multiple physical elements. Also, elements cannot be part of multiple associations. So we cannot associate an analytical member, for example, multiple times. He will be part in one association. So this analytical to physical association manager can be accessed using this method, yet analytical to physical association manager. It's one manager per Revit document. How to add or remove the association. So we have two methods, add association, which you will receive an element ID for an analytical element and an element ID for a physical element. So these elements should not be part of other associations. Also, the analytical elements that can be associated are members and panels. And for physical elements, they can be part of multiple categories like columns, floor, walls, railings, ramps, trusses, beam systems. Yeah, and I think the list is bigger than that. Also, for removing the association, we have a method remove association. This method removes the association for the element with the given element ID. Sorry. In order to view the involved elements in association, so we have get associated element ID, which will return the ID of the element which is associated with the element with this element ID. And also, in order to verify for a certain element that has or not an defined an association, we also have a method has association. In order to check the connection status for an analytical node, we introduced a new class. We called it analytical node data, which this class holds information about the connection status of an analytical node. We have a method for accessing this. So we have a get analytical node data for a certain element. It will return null if this element doesn't have an analytical node data associated with it. And then we have a method for returning the connection status. The connection status can have two values, connected or unconnected. This information can be used probably for application who wants to somehow verify what elements are connected and which are not connected. Now these were the new elements. Now, the other analytical elements like analytical links, boundary conditions, loads, were migrated to work with these newly created elements. So the API for this for links, boundaries, and loads remains in most of the cases the same. Some modifications were made to, for example, for loads, the creation methods were changed a little bit. They will receive an element ID for host over the host element. In the current solution, they receive the analytical model stick element or the analytical model surface. We modified this, we created new methods for receiving the element ID. And also we exposed some methods for verifying if the hosts are valid or not for hosting loads. So for example, if you want to check if an element is valid to host a line load, we can call this line load is valid host, and it will return true or false depending if the element is valid or not. Now we will going to see some samples with this new API that I just showed you. So for example, add new associations between a physical and an analytical element. So this is a small sample where you can see, so we can select an analytical element and a physical element. So we support one-to-one association. We plan to support many-to-many in the future. In this small sample here, We then obtained the analytical to physical association manager for this document. And after that, we called other association for this analytical and physical and for the analytical and physical element. It's it's pretty simple. Then we have here a small sample, how to edit boundary for an analytical panel using SketchEdit scope. So SketchEdit scope will start the transaction group. After the SketchEdit scope is started, an application can start transaction and edit the sketch. And all the individual transactions which application creates inside this SketchEdit scope will not appear in the undo menu. All the transactions committed during the edit mode will be merged into a single one, which will have the name passed into the SketchEdit scope constructor. So you can see here, so we start a sketch edit scope using start with new sketch method for a certain analytical panel. And for example, like you can see in this, in the right picture, we have a rectangular panel and we want to replace a line with an arc. So then after we start the sketch session, then we can get the sketch for the panel. And after that, we have here a small code that finds the first line and creates an arc instead of it. All the model curves which are created inside the SketchEdit scope are added automatically in the sketch. And yes, as I said in the when I showed you the panel, the when you are using this method, the geometry will, if the elements are connected, the elements will be disconnected if the end nodes are not in the same, don't have the same position. If you want to, if application wants to move an analytical node and but keeping the connection between elements, this is a way of achieving this. So like in the picture here, we have a panel and a member which have a common node. And let's say an application wants to move that common node, but still wants to keep the connection between the member and panels. This is a way of achieving this. So using the element transform util move element method for the selected node. So application, so user must be select the common node and then call this method move element, which will move the node to the desired position, but still keeping the member and the panel connected. Now, a small sample here on how to check the connection status for an analytical node. Yeah, so select an application can select an analytical node. For that node, we can then return the analytical node data associated with that node. And then associated the node, analytical node data can having this data, we can obtain the connection status, which can be connected or unconnected. In this way, application can see which elements are connected and which are not. For an for example, for an analytical member, if a node is unconnected, then I don't know, for example, that member will have an end which is free and is not connected by any other element. And in this way, application can, I don't know, mark this as an error, or I don't know, whatever they want. Yeah, so now we are going to talk a little bit about the deprecation of the current solution of the derived analytical model. So the derived analytical model API is deprecated since July. And the following classes together with all their methods are deprecated. and will be removed from the public API once the new implementation is released. This has the main classes, so analytical model, model stick, column, yeah, and so on, model surface. Once it will be released, existing add-ins which are built on top of the Revit should be migrated to work with the new API. Other analytical elements like links, boundaries, loads will remain the same. They were migrated to work with these new analytical elements, but of course, probably some minor changes should be also done for these elements also, because some parts of the API might be changed for them also. Yeah, so here we have a list of properties which are deprecated. Most of these properties are from structural settings class. Some methods which are deprecated from elements. So get this, this is the current way of getting the analytical model for a physical element. These methods are deprecated, and instead of this, application should use that association manager, which I showed you. Also some enums which are deprecated. Yeah, of course, the list of deprecated classes and methods and properties, it's not final and can be modified. And now we can answer a few questions if you have. So we have here in many-to-many relationship, where is the analytical considered?
I think I can answer this one. The analytical, the way the analytical is created, it's totally up to the users. We will provide some Dynamo scripts that will automate the creation for, let's say, it's mostly a sample for framing structure or for structure made out of walls, floors, and columns and beams, regular structures. The analytical representation, it will not be created by default once the physical is created like it was before. It needs a coder, and the code allows you to build it wherever you need it. So in a many-to-many, I assume that will be something depending on each case.
Okay, another question. What is the final specification for the relationships? How will they actually work? Which parameters will be transferred between the two of them? How will they be linked? So in the status of the implementation today, so the relation between physical and analytical is one-to-one relationship. The relation is just for knowing who is the associated element. In the current status of the implementation, we are not transferring parameters between analytical and physical elements, but we are planning to do this in the future. How will they be linked? So just to know who is the associated element. In the current implementation, there is no synchronization between physical and analytical element. We are planning to add this kind of features in the future implementation.
From the API point of view, you can do much more than that. We enable this, let's call it freedom, to build this relationship and parameters transfer. And as I mentioned, on creation, that Dynamo package will offer, create an article based on physical, takes some parameters from the physical and move it on the corresponding analytical counterpart, and in the end, reconnect the entire analytical model so it will be ready for analysis, let's say. Yeah, might need some intervention there. But except this Dynamo package, will not provide, at least in this stage, geometrical and parameters relationship between physical and physical analytical counterpart or counterparts. Okay. Another question, I see it on chat. Do you support a continuous beam with, for example, three columns connected to it? Yeah, I think yeah, you can build now the analytical model without using physical as context, but not depending on it. So the way the physical, I think this is one of the most important thing we wanted to solve. So the way the physical is built should not matter anymore. In terms of splitting command, currently it doesn't work. It's on our list. I think it will be there. But yeah, even without splitting, we can model directly to analytical members there. Yes, I see another one. Is the results manager working now? Yeah. Results manager, if I'm not wrong, now it's
working. Yes, it's working. This results manager, results explorer robot add-in will be migrated to work with this new analytical implementation.
Yeah, I think in the next preview release, if you check it, if you'll check it, it will be able to use it. It works with robot, yeah. I think 1 week ago, November preview release was there, but a new one will be available soon.
Has anything changed with it, with the robot add-in?
With the result explorer, I think.
Oh, with the result
explorer. Results manager. Yeah.
I don't think changes were made. The results manager will be migrated to work with this new implementation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, without any change, if I'm not wrong. Okay. I don't see any other questions. Of course, you can contact us directly on the preview release forum, or now you know our names and our emails. So, yeah. If you have other questions, yeah, we are here.
If no other questions, I have a couple of questions. So the preview release we have right now is you have all the changes?
Yeah.
All the changes, okay. So anybody can test it now, right?
Exactly, yeah. It's there since, I think, June or July. Mm-hmm. The November preview release, which is already online, contains most of these things you've seen today. The next one will have them all. But most of the things are already there.
So most of them, okay. And then this is a kind of reminder as a general things, you know, the time goes quickly and then it's end of the year. So, you know, if you have we strongly encourage you to test now. Not to wait until next year. So it will be probably too late. If we report something January, it might be too tight to change, right? So it's better to check it now. Yeah. And then another thing is thinking about the design automation you said. So all these new API is done in a DB side, right? Not the UI. No, nothing related to UI, or is this, I saw some sketch mentioned about sketches. Are they related to UI, or because we can't use a UI related component in design automation?
No, so the sketch sketch editing that I just present you refers on how to edit a sketch-based element in Revit. Mm-hmm. This the sketch edit scope is the recommended way for applications to be used when they want to edit sketch-based element in Revit. Our analytical panels and opening are sketch-based elements, so this is the recommended way for editing them.
Okay, so that means that can we use the design automation?
Design automation?
Yeah, I think yes. Yeah.
Yes.
I don't see any impediments there.
Okay. All right. So any other questions? Anybody? So the if we have the third party developer has a question, the best way will be raising in the preview page, right? Preview site.
We are
hoping that we'll going to test and you'll give us our feedback.
Also, this presentation, the recording and the presentation will be available there if you want to take a second look and. Okay. Everything is simple.
Good. Okay, great. Thank you very much. So if there is no other questions, then we can finish this then. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Catherine and Romeo. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everybody. Bye.